Now we know that there are Christians who truly can enjoy God's peace and God's joy in this world. But yet, many a times, we also know that there are other children of God who are always stuck in their own issues and they remain in powerlessness. You know, as we hear, you know, very often we hear prayer requests, you know, God, I'm so weak. You know, God, I'm so stuck. God, I'm so struggling. So there's these two different types of Christian. One, someone who always can enjoy God's peace and power wherever they go, whatever the situation. Another group, they are Christian, they are children of God, but yet they are always, you know, powerless, they are always challenged. So what makes the difference? And I would say that the key difference lies in how much the Christian truly understand and believe in the promise of God. Actually, the promise of God is everything. The promise of God is the central of our Christian faith. It's the focal point. Think about it. Without an understanding, without the faith in God's promise, if we do a lot of Bible study, it just becomes what? It just becomes a lot of theological knowledge. And you know, when we forgot and when we miss the point about God's promise and we pray, what happens to that prayer? It becomes a rather aimless and sort of a one-way direction in our prayers. You know, when we pray, we do not know why we get something and why we don't get something, when we didn't have this promise in our mind. So promise directs a lot of things in our faith living. In fact, when we do not have the faith and understanding of God's promises, our faith living is just what? It's just futile religion. Because we are just aimless. You know, sometimes we get answers, we're very happy. Sometimes when we don't have answers, we also don't know what's the perfect will. And so the reason why a lot of believers of God, sometimes we mourn and sometimes they fail to bear fruit in our life. And what's the reason for that? The reason is because many a times these children of God, in their thinking, in their life goals, in their life priorities, in the way they live out their life, they are apart from the focal point of God's covenant. They are not laying whatever they did, whatever they are thinking, on the foundation of God's promises. But on the other hand, we know that, I hope we belong to the second group of believers. If we are a believer who can understand God's promise and who always based on the promise of God to set our fixed perspective, you know, to interpret everything around us, then we can be someone who gets to meet God very easily and we get to hear God very easily and we can make sense of our life clearer. And because the promise of God is such an important component in our Christian faith, that's why today in our passage, you will read again how God came to remind Abram again about what God promised him. And so today, we will look at Genesis chapter 15. And I'll read portions of this passage. So after this, so what is this? If you still recall, what is this after this? What happens in Genesis chapter 14? That was when Abram, he went to war with the Gentile kings and he safely, successfully rescued his nephew. So after this, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. Do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield, your very great reward. I don't know whether you read this. Do you find it strange? Why did God tell Abram, don't be afraid? You know, he just won a battle. What's there to be afraid? He should be very happy and very assured. You know, he may be even proud of his strength, you know, that or he may be very assured that God will protect him all the way. So there must be a reason why God is now telling Abram, no, do not be afraid. And the answer is not difficult to decipher because we as fallen humans, no matter how blessed we are, no matter how many times we've experienced God's grace, you ask yourself, how easy it is for us to be seized with fear again. You know, you may have just received prayer answers yesterday. You may have just saw a wonderful miracle of God yesterday or last week. But it's so fast, the sudden worry, the sudden anxiety, the sudden fear will just come upon us so quickly. And so yes, you know, although Abram, he won his battle in Genesis chapter 14, but here in Genesis 15, the first verse, God came to tell him, don't be afraid. So probably, you know, even after winning the battle, Abraham may be thinking, you know, I'm still a foreigner in this land. You know, I'm not the owner of even one inch of this land. I'm still a foreigner, second-class citizen. And at that point in time, he still has no offspring. So perhaps, you know, there's certain concerns in the heart of Abram. And just like, you know, all of us, we are blessed child of God. I mentioned we receive answers before. But circumstances and situations, even people's words and the devil's lies always make us doubt. Is God really going to fulfill his promise? Is the promise relevant to me, or is the promise only given to someone beside me, the person sitting beside me, but not me? So a lot of times we need to hear God's reassuring word. And what is God's, you look at this verse, what is God's solution to human fear? And of course, it's very clear. His solution to human fear is he himself. Notice that God didn't say, you know, do not be afraid, Abraham. I'm not going to give you any more trouble. You know, you have fought the four kings or the five kings, you know, so I think he has fought the five kings. So, you know, you have fought all these kings. You're not going to have any more suffering. But God didn't say, you know, don't be afraid because you have no more suffering. God says, do not be afraid because I am your reward. In other words, I am with you. And so this verse 1 is a very apt reminder. Why? Because if you notice, if you still recall, Abram, he just rejected the king of Sodom's offer of wealth to him. And so sometimes, you know, this Abraham may be thinking, "Aiya, you know, I just lose out on this opportunity of wealth." But God came to him very timely to tell him that, you know, you don't think you have lose out because I am your great reward. You know, sometimes I don't know about you, as you're journeying on your faith journey, I don't know whether sometimes you feel you also lose out something for the sake of the gospel. You know, some people, they will say, you know, because of the gospel, I've lost certain relationship. Maybe some family relationship becomes strained. Maybe we have lesser time and chemistry with our secular friends. Or some people say, you know, because of the gospel, I've lost the chance for promotion and for greater wealth. And because of the gospel, I've lost, you know, some people say, I've lost more time to sleep, to rest. Every time I come to church, have to serve, have to do God stuff. So sometimes we also maybe, you know, just like Abram, you know, just after we grandly rejected the king of Sodom's offer of wealth, sometimes we may sit down and we say, it seems like, you know, for the sake of the gospel, I've lost this and lost that. But now God is trying to reassure Abram as he's reassuring us that as long as we continue to live by the word of God, with him in the priority, we will not lose out. He will be our greatest reward. But then look at what Abraham responded. But Abram said, so there's this but. You know, God told him this wonderful assurance. You know, I am your very, not just great reward, very great reward. But Abram said, Sovereign Lord, what can you give me since I remain childless and the one who will inherit my estate is Eliezer of Damascus? And Abram said, you have given me no children, so a servant in my household will be my heir. So do you think Abraham understood God's words just now? Do you think he understood? You know, God is telling him, you know, God just told Abraham that I will be your reward. But then now Abraham is concerned about what God can give him. You know, a lot of times God is telling you, I am the reward. You know, what better thing can you have? But now Abraham, despite hearing about this best gift, he's only looking out for circumstances. He's looking out for something external. He's still thinking about his physical offspring. So, I mean, nothing wrong about looking out for tangible blessing. But the thing is, now all Abraham is concerned about is this physical blessing, more than seeking God, more than considering, why did God say he's my great reward? What is the secret inside? He's not concerned about that. But nonetheless, God replied Abram very lovingly. And God told Abram, Then the word of the Lord came to Abram, This man will not be your heir, but the son who is your own flesh and blood will be your heir. So notice this covenant of God is always a very what? It's a personal covenant. God assured Abram, a son from your own flesh and blood, from your own body, will be the promised son. It's not someone else's son. It's not, you know, the son of your, it's not your servant, the son of someone else, but it is your very son. Just like earlier on, we heard that God told Abram, I am your reward. God didn't say, I am someone else's reward. You know, so this covenant of God, we must receive it personally. We do not just, otherwise we will never see God as our reward, because forever we will just think that, oh, God only answer other people's prayer. God give other people joy. But we need to, how can we be connected closely to God? We need to first be assured that today God doesn't just want to be the personal God of every holy, holy person. God wants to be your personal God. God wants to forgive your sin. God wants to forgive my sins. God wants to be my master. God wants to answer my prayer. So we need to really consider this covenant in a very personal way. And so after God told him this, next verse, God took Abram outside and said, "Look up at the sky and count the stars, if indeed you can count them." Then God said to Abram, "So shall your offspring be." And this this final verse for this portion, Abram believed the Lord and he credited to him as righteousness. Now this verse 6 is a very important verse. We'll look at it later because you'll find that this verse later on was repeated in the New Testament in Romans chapter 4 and Galatians chapter 3. But before that, let's consider verse 1 first. What did God say? Now this verse 1 is not just mentioned to Abram. It is today God's word for you. As you're sitting here, God is trying to impress in our hearts that he is our very great reward also. So now, what is this great reward? This great reward is not the promised land. It's not the land of Canaan. And this great reward is also not what? It's not a son. It's not the offspring, even though, you know, Abram have been pining and yearning, longing after for one son. So in the same way for us, when God, you know, when we come to God, we always pray for reward, right? God, reward me for being obedient to your commandments. Lord, reward me for believing in you. So what is that real reward? Even for us, the real reward for us is not, it's not a good result. It's not promotion. It's not a spouse. It's not money. It's not health, etc. Even though we also need those things and we long for those things. But God didn't mention those things as the very great reward. They are just secondary rewards. They're just fringe benefits. But the reward is not something that God can give, but the reward is God himself. And this is something that, as a follower of Christ, is something that we need to continue to taste and confirm again and again. How do you taste it? Because at first reading, you would not agree to it. What does it mean by, you know, my reward is not good result, it's not health and wealth, all these are very good ones. But when you have wealth, when you have very good friends, when you have good result, then you start to taste and confirm, this cannot 100% satisfy me. This cannot fully make me happy forever. So we need to test again and again before we can resonate with this sentence about God himself being our very great reward. Now then you ask us the question, how, why? Why is God and not anything else our greatest reward? Why? I mean, for a Christian to believe this is very cliche, it's very easy, but why? You need to understand the reason, then you can direct your heart to believe this truth. So why? Why is God our only reward? Because the truth is, no matter how much you like other things, there's a possibility of being lost. Now, if you face a possibility of losing something, you know, some people ever said this, if I know I will lose this particular thing one day, I hope I will never, I don't even have it in the first place. You know, if you have a first love, or if I will break up one day, I hope I never even fall in love in the first place. If this friend is to hurt me, or I will lose the friendship, I hope I never even get to know this friend at all, or etc., etc. So why is it that other rewards cannot be the greatest reward for us? Because there's a possibility that other rewards may be lost. But what God really wants to give those whom he loves is something eternal, something unchanging. And so, because God, he never changed. When he says, "I love you," he never changes his mind. No matter today we follow him faithfully or we are a bit naughty, you know, we are drawn by the world, we forget him a bit. Because God never changes. So, it is our greatest assurance when he said that he is our reward, because God never changes. So this reward can or cannot be lost. Now, who is very angry with us getting reward? Satan. No, Satan is not happy that we got blessing. So Satan is not happy that things go well with us. But the truth is, no matter how Satan is angry or unhappy that we have reward, he can do nothing to rob us of this reward, who is God himself. Because no one can manipulate God. You know, Satan, you know, sometimes he may give us obstacle, you know, in our career, in our health, put a thorn in our flesh, etc. But no matter how unhappy the devil is, he can do nothing to rob us of God's love. And that's God's promise in Romans chapter 8, right? Nothing can separate us from the love of God. And so, the reason why God says he is our very great reward, remember this, is because he never changes his mind. And because he never changes his mind, this reward will never be gone, will never be taken away from us. Now, you consider, you compare this God with any other thing that you consider as your great reward now. Now, is it, are you now very yearning after human praise? Now, we also know human praise, is it stable? You know, sometimes, you know, you put in a lot of hard labor, people don't appreciate your work. But God, he always appreciates us, even without us contributing anything yet. You know, even when we are still sinners, we only contribute to what? Sinning. When we didn't contribute anything, God already appreciates us. He sees the value in us. He finds us so precious that he's willing to die for us. And so, if we consider human praise as our reward, God appreciates us even more. And if you see, you know, for modern day people, if we see the fun that we derive from our handphone is our great reward. You know, all you want, all you look forward to at the end of the day, I don't know, for the youth or what, is maybe you have the permission to touch your handphone after 2 hours or maybe 1 hour of doing homework. Or maybe all of you are very relaxed. You have your home, you have access to your handphone all day long. But, you know, sometimes we look forward to this entertainment, this relaxation we get. But you ask yourself, will the thrill of the entertainment, will the thrill of the handphone grow boring over time? But the thing about God is, he does new things every day. He has new grace for us every day. And so, if we are willing to look to him, God, he has his way to delight us. And so now we have to ask ourselves, what better blessing can we have other than God? You think about it. Is it already amazing for God to have pity on us who are sinners? But God do not just have pity on us. God loves us even though we are sinners. You know, there's a difference between pity and love, right? Think about it. If you go on the street and you donate to the person asking for money, you have pity on the person. When you give the person $10, it's already very amazing, right? Wow, you give the person $10. But then if you bring the person on the street home, you take care of the person, you love the person with your life, that is something incredible. Now, we are sinners. We are like beggars. I mean, we deserve nothing. But God, he not just have pity on us. More than that, he loved us with his life. So you ask yourself, we ask ourselves, what better reward can we get other than God's love? Now, you know, a lot of people in the world, they may think that what is their best reward? The common thing that people in the world will consider as their reward is what? Is money. Why? Because people always think, when I have a lot of money, that is my reward because it boosts my self-value. It makes people hold me in higher regard. You know, when I go to the restaurant, when I go to work, if I have more money, I have more say. But the thing is, if God loves us, So if God loves us, he is not just money. He is the creator of money. He's the possessor of the whole world. If God loves us, it actually will boost our self-worth all the more. If you think that money can boost your self-worth, if you think that, you know, money is my greatest reward, if I have money, I can do a lot of things, I can make people look up to me, I can have reputation, I can have some faith and glory and honor. If God loves us, that can even boost our self-worth even more. Because why? Even the angels with supernatural power, they have to minister to those who believe in God. So God, in many, many different areas, whether it's spiritual aspect, whether it's material aspect, he's our best reward. You know, but after hearing all these things, we still will hear people say, you know, but I still cannot feel how God is my reward. Why? Because, okay, usually when people ask this question, I still cannot feel why God is my reward. What is the reason for them to ask this question? Usually their basis is, their perspective is they will be looking at, he didn't give me anything. What can God give me? What has God given me? So a lot of people, when they cannot feel that God is their reward, the thing directing their mind and heart to that conclusion is they will always look at, what has God give me? He has not answered my prayer. He didn't give me what I want. But dear brothers and sisters, we need to be very glued to the truth. What does the truth tell us? You know, sometimes our physical eyes, our heart, always question, what did God give me? How did He answer my prayer? But we need to register the truth. And what is the truth? The truth is, there is absolutely nothing in future that God is going to give you that is already better than what He has already given you. Do you understand what I'm saying? Okay, maybe you can read. God, there's nothing He can ever do in future that is more than what He has already done for us. Because we know that He's already given His life, His every drop of blood, His very own sacrifice to redeem us, to die on the cross. What do you think He can give us in future that is better than His completed salvation work? If He give us a better spouse, spouse only one. If He give you a spouse, if He give you good result, if He give you praise of men, if He give you success in life, even if He give you some spiritual anointing, you know, gift of tongues or gift of prophecy or whatever, nothing that God is going to do or give you in future that will supersede what He has already done, because the work of salvation is completed and is done deal. You know, when we put our trust in His blood on the cross, we belong to heaven forever. So, you know, a lot of people, so to those people who always are still waiting for what better things, what better blessing God can give me still, now we need to register the truth repeatedly in our mind. We need to keep asking ourselves and confirming until our heart change according to the truth that whatever God is going to give me in future is not going to surpass what He has done so far. And not just He has given us His very life. He gave us a promise. When He ascended to heaven, He told His disciples, do not worry, do not be sorrowful, because I leave this earth to prepare a place for you in heaven. And He has given us that best blessing. So this is something, you know, when we know the truth, we can use the truth to do what? To rebuild our hearts when our hearts are foolish, when our hearts doubt God because of circumstances, because of our feeling. No, the truth is meant to be used. The truth is not just meant to be known in the knowledge. No, because we know the truth, sometimes when we sense that our heart is foolish, why are we doubting God? Why are we reducing the wonder of God? When we find our hearts being foolish, we need to use the truth to tame our hearts. And because God is our greatest reward, we need to pray that we can turn our sighing into singing. This is just like, you know, when Hannah, you know Hannah, she's barren. Remember when she's always sighing, what did her husband told her? Am I not more to you than 10 sons? You know, so sometimes for whatever reason you are sighing, practice this. You know, sometimes I practice to myself. You know, when I'm very busy or when I'm very bored with my life. I mean, thank God for me, I don't have very serious problems so far. So my problem very small. So sometimes it's like, oh, when I'm very bored, you know, why every day is the same? You know, why I'm so busy? You know, why this and why that? I always remind myself, and I replay this question. Isn't God better? You know, and you know, I'm a person of not extreme. I'm a person who is very based on fairness, right? So when I sense something is unfair, it can irritate me for days and hours and make me very angry. But every time when I feel something is unjust or not fair, and I cannot find a fair way out, sometimes I ask God, God asked me this question. Am I not more to you than, you can fill in the blank, than free time, than fairness, than whatever things that you look forward to? So God is also asking us today, am I not more to you than praises of men? Am I not more to you than your health, your wealth, or all the world? When you think deeply about this question, you know, sometimes when I think deeply about this question, and is God not more to me than anything else? A lot of anxiety, a lot of fear, a lot of injustice, a lot of sense of anger or whatever, or grumbles will dissolve. And so I pray that, you know, whenever we hear God ask us this kind of question, you know, am I not more to you than whatever? Our reply can be the same as the psalmist, and that's what we read just now. Whom have I in heaven but you? and earth has nothing I desire besides you. This sounds very absolute. Wow. Earth has nothing I desire. We desire food, we desire beauty, etc. But there's this emphasis, nothing I desire more than you on earth. So I pray that, you know, as we walk more with God, this increasingly be our heart. But then if you ask, if God says He is our reward, the reward must be for something. What is the reward for? What's the reason for the reward? And so we know that God rewards those who believe in Him and who obey Him. In other words, that's verse 6 that I mentioned, which is a very important verse for us to think through today. So verse 6 tells us, Abram believed the Lord and he credited to him as righteousness. Now the question we need to ask ourselves is, why was Abram justified? And that's, of course, you can read here, there's only one reason for his justification, his faith. But you need to think about it. Now, Abram, he has a lot of obedient good works. If you count, although we read about his weaknesses, Abraham, he's very obedient. You know, when God asked him to leave, he leaves. When he has to split between himself and Lot, he actually is willing to be disadvantaged. And he told Lot, you can choose first. And then when there's a trouble of going out to war to save his nephew, he bothered to take the trouble to save his nephew and go into war. And then not just that, when the king of Sodom offered him the wealth, he rejected, not even the shoelace, you know, I will take from you. And then also he gave tithes to Melchizedek. So, you know, if you look at all these things, well, it seems like Abraham, he's, you know, just now we read in Romans 4, there's this, he's not justified by his work, then there's a dash, though he has something to boast about. You know, so sometimes we also, you know, we don't get mistaken. Sometimes as we follow God, we know in our own heart, people around us also affirm, we know we have something to boast of. You know, we come diligently to the church every week, or we pray every morning, or we read the Bible diligently, etc. But despite the fact that Abraham, he has something to boast about, all these good works does not qualify him for his justification. So he's only justified for one reason, that is his faith. So we need to be very clear. Abraham is not justified by works. This one we all know. But we need to drill it in our mind that Abraham is also not justified by 50% work, 50% faith. You know, we always are a bit confused between what is the truth and what is a lie. So what is the truth? The truth is real faith will always produce good works. That is the truth. If your faith is real, you will have good works. Now, what is the lie between faith and work? So the truth is, real faith will, of course, bring you justification, and also real faith will produce good works. But what is the lie? This is the lie that always hit us, always come at us. No matter how many years Christians we have been, we sometimes unknowingly fall into this lie again. And the lie tells you, faith and works collaborate 50-50%, same weightage or in certain percentage. Faith and work together to bring about our righteousness. So this is the lie that we need to always break down. Because, you know, a lot of times I'm surprised, you know, when I talk to people in the church, even people who have been very long in the church circle. A lot of times when you ask them about their assurance of faith, salvation, I'm quite surprised that they cannot give a very sure answer. Actually, I don't know whether I should say this. My husband just, Chen Ji just taught Sunday school 2 weeks ago, I think 2 weeks ago, about assurance of salvation. And then so I think he asked for this survey and asked which of you is very assured that you are safe among the children. And I think he mentioned that only 3% raised their hand. You all know who are the 3? So I was a bit surprised. The whole class of children being groomed in our church, when asked this fundamental question, how many of you are very sure you'll be safe? Only 3 raised their hand. And the 3 are the pastor's children. So I don't know what happened to the rest. But so then it's a bit awakening, because a lot of times, all of us, we have known the truth for so many times. We felt, you know, this truth, we have heard so many times. But the thing is, even for us adults, sometimes we realize that at moments where we felt we have done a lot for God, when we felt that we have been following God very closely, we feel more assured and we can raise our hand very high, you know, I'll be in heaven. But at times when we felt like we haven't been praying for ages, we are numb when we come to church, or we are not interested when we sing the hymns or etc., then we start to feel a bit uncertain when we felt we have shortchanged God. So this is something we need to battle. Justification is not a cooperation of both works and faith, but justification is by faith alone. As long as in your heart you truly believe that Jesus is the one God who can save you, all of us, we can, without embarrassment, call ourselves righteous, even though we still sin. But then, now we know that even though faith is the only factor that brings about justification, but let me ask you, is our faith that brings about justification a perfect faith? Is your faith perfect? Which of you can say, my faith is very perfect? So now, how can an imperfect faith justify a sinner? But that is the truth. Because I want to borrow the words of Charles Spurgeon. The faith which justified Abram was still an imperfect faith. And I think for his whole life on earth, he's still forever going to be imperfect because he's a fallen man for as long as he's on earth. But it perfectly justified him. So this is our good news and our comfort. Because why is the gospel good news? Because we do not need to have perfect faith to be saved. And we thank God for that. You know, if the criteria to be saved is faith, and it needs to be a consistent, unwavering, forever strong faith, then also all of us die. Because we can have faith today, we may not have faith tomorrow. And our faith can waver at the change of any circumstance. But the wonderful thing is, God is not demanding a perfect faith. God just, even Jesus said, if you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you can even move mountains. And so, indeed, then you ask, but how is this logical? You know, our faith is not perfect. How can it perfectly justify us? Where is the logic? Who has the answer? Who has the solution? You know, this is an imperfect faith. How can he bring about a perfect solution? How can he bring about a perfect salvation? And that's another thing we need to drill in our heart. Our faith may be weak and small, but what is powerful? The object of our faith. So I really like this. Actually, I was thinking about this thing, but then I realized there's a quote by Timothy Keller. And he said, okay, our faith may be weak, but the object of our faith is powerful. And Timothy Keller said this, it is not the strength of our faith, but the object of our faith that actually saves us. Remember this. Because at the end of the day, it's not human-centric. It's God-centric. So it cannot be based on the strength, the consistency, the intensity of our faith. If that's the case, as I said, we all have no hope because I cannot guarantee how strong my faith will be. But it's not about the strength of our faith, but the object of your faith that actually saves you. Because strong faith in a weak branch is fatally inferior to a weak faith in a strong branch. Okay, this second line is the illustration. Actually, I find this quote because I need this illustration. So think about it. If you trust 100% in a lousy branch and you cling on to it, it will break and you will fall and you will die. But you believe a little bit. You know, sometimes you believe, sometimes you do, but you still hang on, you know, in a strong branch. You will still not die because the branch will not break. You hold on to it, you'll be safe. So this is the thing about our justification by faith. God is an understanding God. He's a reasonable God. He knows that he cannot demand perfect faith from us fallen humans. Even after becoming a Christian, we still struggle with sin, with doubts, with a lot of weaknesses. So God says, as long as you trust in the right object, and that is me, God, you'll be safe. And what else that makes, what's another thing that about Abram's faith that makes his faith so commendable, you know, that he is justified? What's so commendable about Abram's faith? Because at this point in time, Abraham is believing in something very hopeless. You know, if I ask you to believe in something very hopeful, it's very easy, right, you know? If I ask you to believe that the chair will not break in the next 5 minutes, maybe it's easy to believe. But now Abraham at the point where God makes a covenant with him, he has no land, as I keep mentioning. He has no son. He has nothing. But God is telling him grand things. So God is telling him very far-fetched things. You know, God is not just telling him you have a son. But there's a lot of mitigating factors. He just now we read his body from Romans chapter 4. His body is dead. It's as good as dead, 100 years old. And not just his body is dead. His wife's body is, his wife's womb is as good as dead also. And God did not just tell him you have one son. God said you will have countless offspring. And again, as I said, you know, now he's still a foreigner in this. You know, those of you who are not yet Singaporean, you try to buy a house, it's quite difficult, right? No, so now Abraham is now in this foreign land. God said, and he didn't own an inch of the land yet. And God said, you'll be the owner of this land. So everything sounds very impossible. Everything sounds too good to be true. But what's amazing about Abraham's faith is this. And I pray that this is what happened to us also. That the more impossible the situation is, the greater his faith is. And that's why he's so commendable. You know, for our usual intuitive human response is what? The more grim and the more impossible the situation is, the less our faith is. The more we will question God. But Abraham did the opposite. The more impossible the situation seemed, the more he did not waver. And just now we read, you know, in the Bible, in Romans chapter 4, this is encouraging faith testimony of Abraham. He did not waver through unbelief regarding the promise of God. He did not waver, even though there's so many circumstances that aim to waver him, but he didn't waver. But he was strengthened in his faith. So the opposite happened. The circumstances should have killed his faith, but his faith was strengthened, and he gave glory to God, being what? Being fully persuaded that God had power to do what he has promised. And this is why it was credited to him as righteousness. And so now you ask yourself, why is Abraham's faith so pleasing to God? And you ask yourself, how did Abraham get that kind of faith? Is it easy to have that kind of faith? No. But how? So now we know this is the reality. Abraham, he was able to have that kind of faith. Then now if we want to be like him, we need to ask the question, how did he get that kind of faith? He did only one simple step. And I pray that this is the one simple step we try to practice when it's our turn. Abraham merely did one thing. He shifted his eyes from himself to God. Just one thing. You know, because a lot of times, it's actually either this or that. Either you look at the circumstances and situation and look at your own condition and you get shaken, or you look at God and you get secured. So Abraham only did one thing to get this kind of faith. He shifted his eyes from looking at himself, his ability, his conditions, his circumstances, and he looked to God. Look to what of God? Look to God's strength. Look to God's character. Look to God's power. Look to God's trustworthiness, that if God said he will do this thing, God promised he will do this thing, God will surely bring it to pass. And so this is the faith that pleases God. And this is the difference between fallen man and regenerated man. Because why? A fallen man will always look at himself, an external factor. But the regenerated, born-again person will always look at God. So this is the difference. So even for us, you know, just now we also read, when it's mentioned, it's credited to him. It's not just written for Abraham. It's written for us also. So if we want to be justified by faith also, then our faith should be the same as Abraham's. Meaning to say, even though we also have our impossible things, you know, it seems in the first place impossible for us to be saved. Now, if you are truly born again person, this is of course your first, we need to have this first realization. How is it possible that I can be saved? First of all, I'm such a sinner. Second, I'm a hardened, stubborn sinner. You know, sinner is just one thing. If you're a sinner, and somebody tell you, you know, you can find forgiveness in this place, it quickly go. It's not bad. It's still not bad. But a lot of times, sinners are still stubborn. We need forgiveness, and people tell us there's this way for forgiveness, and we reject that way. And we think we do not need that kind of forgiveness. So sometimes, we also, when we try to relate to Abraham, we also need to realize that even though it's impossible for us, it's too good to be true that we are safe, but God still saved us. So again, why is God's grace so amazing? If God saves saints, he's already amazing, but God saves sinners, so he's all the more amazing. And I pray that, you know, just as Abraham, he believed in God and it was credited to him as righteous. We pray that we also, whatever contradicting circumstances we are facing, as long as we believe in God, God will also credit to us as our righteousness, and God will show us evidence that following Him, believing in Him, is the right choice. And so, now we mentioned that, you know, Abraham is justified by faith. So now the question is, what next? What's next after justification? So we will read Genesis chapter 15, verse 7 onwards for further information. So God also said to Abram, I'm the Lord who brought you out of Ur of the Chaldeans to give you this land to take possession of it. But Abram said, Sovereign Lord, how can I know that I will gain possession of it? And because of this question asked by Abram, later in we jump to verse 12, God made a covenant, a formal covenant with Abram. So as the sun was setting, Abram fell into a deep sleep, and a thick, dreadful darkness came over him. Then the Lord said to Abram, Know for certain that for 400 years, your descendants will be strangers in a country not their own, and that they will be enslaved and mistreated there. But I will punish the nation they serve as slaves, and afterward they will come out with great possessions. You, however, will go to your ancestors in peace and be buried at a good old age. In the fourth generation, your descendants will come back here, for the sin of the Amorites had not yet reached its full measure. So sometimes, even though God delayed, you know, maybe at this, Abraham could be very happy, you know, when God made the covenant. Then later God said, the covenant will be fulfilled 400 years later and you will die by the time. He'll be saying, chair, you know. But then actually God has a reason for his delay, because God is not an impulsive God. He has to wait for, you know, he cannot just punish the Canaanites for nothing. He has to wait for their sins to reach its full measure. And in between this, there's also lessons he's teaching his chosen people. And so verse 17, when the sun had set and darkness had fallen, a smoking fire pot with a blazing torch appeared and passed through the pieces. On that day, the Lord made a covenant with Abram and said, To your descendants I give this land, from the Wadi of Egypt to the great river, the Euphrates, and then to a lot of different names that I cannot read. So it's to all these Gentiles, all these pagans. And so here we need to understand, we are like Abraham, that we have already been justified by faith. So after being justified by faith, the next instruction that God has for us is, don't go back to the past. Don't go back to the past belief, don't go back to the past bondages. Because why? Because God has a new inheritance for us. You know, just like, you know, here God is telling Abram, you settle down in this foreign land, because one day it will be yours. Do not go back to your previous hometown. No matter how many fun memories you have, no matter how many friends you have back in your own town, no matter how many properties you have, or achievement or treasure, do not go back, because after you are justified, I'll give you a new inheritance. So likewise for us, after we become Christians, God gives us new inheritance. God doesn't want us to be stuck in our old mindset, be stuck in our old problem, be stuck in our old anxiety, and be stuck in our old way of solution. God wants us to move on, because He has new inheritance for us. He has new blessings, He has new peace, new grace. And so, of course, you know, we can continue to do what we like. And when I say we don't go back to the past, we can still do what we like. Before we are Christian, say if you like children, you can continue to work with children. But now, new inheritance means you work with children to point them to God, and you link it with a divine purpose. Before we are Christian, we seek excellence in life. But now, we also can continue to seek excellence in life, but we seek excellence in life not for personal glory, but to honor God and to fulfill His plan. And so, after justification, God wants us to move on to new inheritance. And another thing we need to understand after justified is, are those who are justified never to sin again? We know, of course, we will still sin. But what's so great about justification if after that we will still sin? The good news is, when we are justified, God is for us. Meaning to say, though we will still sin, He promised many, many times forgiveness, 77 times forgiveness, infinite forgiveness. Even though we will still sin, we will not be condemned. So justification, the beauty of justification is God is for us. From the point you are justified, God is for us. And the beautiful promise we had in Romans chapter 8 is, if God is for us, who can be against us? Last time when I was just a small fry in my office, when I cannot even make the secretary listen to me, and sometimes I fear my bosses, I always remember, if God is for me, who can be against me? Will my boss kill me? Will my boss make me a pauper? Just if, in the worst case scenario, she asked me to resign or whatever, I won't become a pauper because God is for me. I still have something to eat. So if God is for us, who can be against us? Not just earthly matters, but all the more spiritual matters. A lot of times, sometimes, you know, some people, some Christians will be asking the question, you know, the Satan is so scary. Satan very powerful. He can waver our faith. He can deceive us, make us fall into temptation. Satan is so scary. So sometimes when I think about what Satan is going to do to me and do to my family and do to my loved ones, sometimes I'll be a bit worried. But I always pray this prayer, God, you are greater than Satan. If you are with us, if you are with me, even though Satan do not want to give us healing, even though Satan do not want us to give us a blessing, even though Satan do not want us to see our family gospelized, whatever, if you are for us, who can be against us? So when we are justified, it means the great implication is God is for us. And because God is for us, no condemnation, no curse is in our life. But the thing is, then you ask this question, because you observe it in life, that although we are not condemned, we are justified, but we are still faced with trouble. So the truth is, a justified person, as the case of Abraham reveals to us, a justified person is not free from troubles. Because you notice how God told Abraham about the troubled future prophecy, prophecy of the troubled future. You know, so Abraham now just make a covenant with God, right? So God told him, you know, you may be making a covenant with me, but you know, in future, your descendants will be slaves and they will live, they'll be tortured by certain people. So although the justified, we also face troubles. But God, he gave us the promise of ultimate victory. And so whatever God told Abraham is exactly the same promise as what Jesus told us in John chapter 16, verse 33. Jesus said, in this world you will have trouble, but take heart, I have overcome the world. And so in other words, what this means is, yes, our life is not free from trouble, but our problem will not harm us, but it will build us up. It will draw us closer to God. Our troubles will be for a little while, but the glory is surely going to outweigh all these things. And so finally, when we after being confirmed that, you know, if we follow the footsteps of Abraham, we will also be justified like him. Final thing I want to touch on today is God made a former covenant with Abraham. You notice that later on, now we are at Genesis chapter 15. Later on, Genesis chapter 17, God is going to renew this covenant again. So you ask, why is God so naggy? Why God always remind? So here in Genesis 15, God is merely reinforcing his promise to Abraham in Genesis 12. So you will notice that throughout your life, God is doing one thing. What is that thing? Reminding. Because we always forget. We always forget how much we need God. We always forget how good God is. We always forget there's no better reward than God. Because new things will come and occupy our heart. And so why is it so critical that for our whole life, just as how God has been reminding Abraham, why is God always reminding us of his covenant? Why? Because everything that happens to us revolves around God's covenant. And so, in other words, if you want to make sense of your life, we need to pray that God help us restore a covenant mindset. I tell you, if you're a lot of Christians, they are puzzled. A lot of Christians, they are disheartened. They are discouraged. They are lost. And they felt that, you know, there's a disconnection between themselves and their prayers and God. Why? Because they didn't have a covenant mindset when they look at everything. I tell you, what's the difference between a covenant mindset and someone who have no covenant mindset? If a Christian have no covenant mindset, the way he interpret his prayers is just like a pagan. It's just like a lay person. And what does a pagan or a non-believer, how do they view things? Good things means God is good. Bad things means God is bad, right? God give me what I want means God is loving. God didn't give me what I want means he doesn't care about me. So this is how a lay person, this is how a non-believer will look at things, totally without this covenant mindset. But for a Christian to make sense of our life, to really build an intimate relationship with God, to know that God is not lying in our life, God is not playing a joke on us, then we need to pray to restore this covenant mindset, to interpret everything. Because without this covenant mindset, we will only let situations direct our heart. But with this covenant mindset, we will let God's truth, which is the covenant, direct our interpretation of the whole situation. So now if I want to talk about covenant mindset, so what is the covenant? I mean, the covenant is the whole book of the Bible. Everything God promised you is inside. But in Jesus, okay, so when we look at Abraham's example, what did God promise him? Usually people will summarize into three things that God promised Abraham. Son, land, and blessing. Blessings to all nations. But for us, you know, you'll be thinking, I need land for what? I just need a HDB flat. Or, you know, I need son for what? Not everyone have son. So for us, we can summarize the whole Bible. You want to restore the covenant mindset. You know, the Bible is such a thick book. But I don't know how many of you, if I ask you to summarize God's promise to you, can you relate it? So in general, it's a few things that God promised us. Every time, and for the whole life, whatever happens to us, God works to fulfill that covenant. First is, so whoever believes in him will be saved and be called his child. Second, God promised that he will be with you. Whether you are in your darkest moment or in your proudest moment, God is with you and he's with you to guide you. Second, God promised that he will answer your every prayer. None of your prayer will be in vain. But of course, his answer may be according to his will, not your desire. And God promised to give you victory. No matter what, you know, so victory, how do you define victory? You won't know until the last moment. Bear this in your mind. A lot of people, before they reach the end, they really think, God didn't give me victory. He only gave me failures all my life. How do you know? You're still breathing. How do you know which are blessings in disguise, which are, you know, victory in disguise? So, how can you define victory? You only can define victory at the end. So sometimes in our life, there's ups and downs, but eventually God promised that to whoever follow him, he will give us ultimate victory. And fifth, as he gave Abraham the promised land, he gave us new inheritance. So just now I mentioned, God doesn't want us to remain secular, remain bound by the world, by the flesh. God gave us new inheritance. Our inheritance is in heaven. We have a place in heaven. We have the citizenship to heaven. And so, these are the brief summary of God's covenant to us. In other words, if you want to make sense of your life, we always need to return to what is it that God wants to fulfill in our life. God's aim in our life is not to make me the most successful businesswoman in this world. And so, of course, things that happen to me, you know, sometimes I fail my exam or sometimes I don't have good grades. That's because I'm not meant to be the smartest person in the world. But God's plan for us is to fulfill his kingdom purpose. It's for us to demonstrate his glory. So when we have the kingdom, when we have the covenant mindset, it's easier to make sense of everything that happens in our life. And God will give continuous evidence. Because if you notice, even though I say God recap his covenant with Abraham in Genesis 15, which is today's chapter, and Genesis 12, do you see a difference? Is God repeating exactly the same word? Is God only telling Abraham, you know, you'll be a father of all nations, and full stop? You know, he told Abraham in Genesis 12, you know, I'll make your name great, you'll be a father of all nations. But is God repeating exactly the same thing in Genesis 15? No, he actually gave more details. He told Abraham, you know, you will die at good old age. He told Abraham 400 years what will happen. So the thing about us and God is, when we walk with God, Okay. Wait. Yeah, when we walk with God, God will reveal more details to us. So sometimes the thing is, when God repeat this covenant to Abraham, it's same as we hear sermon every week. Are we hearing the same, roughly the same content? Yeah, God love you, you need God, you must follow God, then you have blessing. But in every repetition, there are new things. So here, the wonderful thing is as we walk with God, God do not just repeat the same old thing. God will reveal more of His perfect will so that we can understand a bit better. You know, God may say, I will make you bless your family. Maybe the first time you hear is this. After that, God will impress on your heart who in your family you can bless, or what happens, or what must you do, who must you pray more for, etc. So as we walk with God more, we need to confirm for ourselves, did God make us understand His covenant, His promise, His word more and more? Did He reveal more and more of His plans, specific plans to us? So as what God did to Abram, He reveals more to Abram, as he pray more, as he obeys more, God will also reveal more to us. And so finally, when we talk about, to conclude about this covenant that God has made with Abraham, the covenant is both unconditional and conditional. So this is something I want, this is the final thought I want to rest with all of us. The amazing thing about this covenant in Genesis 15, it was that this covenant was made when Abraham was what? If you read the, Abraham was sleeping. He was deeply, soundly asleep. So sometimes it's the same thing, you know, as what Ephesians told us. You know, you were dead in your transgressions and sin, but He made you alive. Now, when Abraham has no, sleeping means what? He has no power to respond. He didn't say, God, I love you. He didn't say, God, I want to sacrifice to you. He didn't say, God, I will do this or that for you. When he didn't do anything, he's non-committal, God made this covenant with him. So that's the beauty part of the gospel. Before we are even interested in God, before even when we can respond to God, God already decided that he wants to bless us and save us. But the thing is, even though, you know, just now we read in Genesis 15 that the covenant was made when Abraham was sleeping, if later on we read Genesis chapter 22, God told Abraham after he offered his son Isaac, God said, because you have done this, done is an action. Because you have offered your son Isaac to me and not withheld your son from me, I will surely fulfill my promise. So you ask, so is this covenant conditional or unconditional? Is both, because it is unconditional from the point of view that God initiated it and God will see through it. But we need to partner God's grace with our obedience. So our obedience need to partner God's grace, then we can see fulfillment. And as we submit more and more to God in obedience, as what Abraham has done, as I said, God will make us see and taste more and more of His covenantal promise. So in summary, I don't have a summary slides today, but in summary, today God wants to impress on our heart through this passage that He is our greatest reward. And why? Why can He be our greatest reward? Because He never changes, and therefore we will never lose this reward. Every other thing changes. Every other thing can be lost. And then whoever believes in God will be justified by faith. Even though our faith is not perfect, but we can trust in the what? In the object of our faith who is powerful. And we pray that, you know, the more impossible our situation is, God will make our faith all the more stronger. And lastly, we all pray to God for this restoration of a covenant mindset. Because only then you can make sense of your life, even the unfortunate events of your life or the good events of your life. When we have a covenant mindset, then we can understand. Sometimes even when God takes away certain things, sometimes when God delays certain things, you know, Abraham wanted a son, but God delayed so many years. It's all for the sake of His covenant. It's all for His glory. And so may God today help us believe, as the title suggests, that God is our reward. There's no better reward than Him. Okay, let's pray. Dear Lord Jesus, we want to thank You for coming to us before we knew how to appreciate You. Lord, today You remind us again that you are our very great reward. Although many a times when we hear things like this, our heart may not immediately resonate with this, because on this earth, there are many other rewards that are holding us, that are tempting us and occupying our hearts and mind. But Lord, we pray that you break through all these lies, you break through all this stubbornness in us, and open our eyes and help us see that indeed, we don't have anyone in heaven but you. On earth, there's nothing better for us to desire but you. So Lord, we pray that you stir our heart, you open our eyes to the truth and not be deceived by the lies. So continue to work in us through your word and give us the faith that you gave Abraham and show us the evidence that you gave him in his life as he walked with you. So Lord, we anticipate your continuous work in our life and we pray all this in Jesus Christ's name. Amen.